Good morning and a blessed Palm Sunday to you as we gather in our homes for another Sabbath day, but knowing that we are united together in spirit. A few announcements related to our church family before we begin our worship service. There will be another Lenten movie watch this Wednesday. We invite you to watch ahead of time the movie Gran Torino, which has Lenten themes of sacrifice and willingness to lay down one's life for another. So if you have a chance to watch that, there will be conversation by Zoom that will follow that on Wednesday evening. I believe that's at 7:30, so plan to be a part of that. Maundy Thursday, there are three churches that are joining together for worship, and that will be streamed live. That will be 7 p.m. Maundy Thursday. Watch our church Facebook page so that you'll know how to connect and be a part of that worship service. For Good Friday, we are doing our prayer vigil, a 24-hour prayer vigil that stretches between noon on Good Friday to noon on Holy Saturday. Last I looked, there were just about four openings left, one of which was like 3 a.m. if you're nocturnal and don't sleep well. Check those openings to see if there's one that you want to take, and by now it may be completely filled. But what we are asking for everyone in our congregation is during the course of Good Friday, at some point, to take time to be prayerful. We will have available to you online a prayer guide, which is scripture and guided prayers. It makes it easy for you to be guided into this time of reflection. So our hope is that each household will take some time on Good Friday, and certainly this year with what our lives are like and what our world is like, I think we can feel Good Friday in a very different way. We will have our Easter Sunday celebration. It will be streamed live at 10:30. There is no doubt that this will be an Easter that we remember, because there's much that doesn't feel very much like Easter. In fact, the Lenten season has matched up perfectly with the coronavirus in terms of the feeling of death and foreboding. But Easter will happen. We will share the good news of the resurrection. There will be music, and so we invite you to join us for that. Today, after the worship service, we invite you to join by Zoom so that we can be in each other's presence. It will be joyful chaos with Zoom. The more people who are on it, the less any one individual is able to talk. But I think we can wave to each other, and we can smile and see each other's faces. So plan to join for a Zoom coffee hour after our service today. So now we prepare for our worship, and our bell rings in our bell tower so that our community knows that we continue to gather to worship our God.
Your goodness, we doubt. Good morning, everyone. We certainly do miss seeing all of you in church each Sunday. It's Friday afternoon as I tape this, and I'm hoping that it will be a beautiful Palm Sunday morning when you listen. Today's scripture reading is Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2, and verses 19 through 29. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession, up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Our scripture reading today comes from Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 44, and it says, "After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, 'Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? Just say this, the Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Jesus, order your disciples to stop.' And he said, I tell you, if they were silent, the stones would shout out. As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, if you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you, and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God. This is the word of the Lord.
Will you join me in prayer as we begin a time of reflection on the scripture? Let's pray. God of all good mercy, we pray that you continue to be with us in this time of worship. We offer you our hearts and our minds, and we turn this time over to you that we might be led to meet you in new ways and be empowered to reach out to our hurting world through your guidance. So now in these human words of meditation, be very near to us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Today is the culmination of a long journey. And so if we look back in Luke's gospel to chapter 9, verse 51, we see where this journey began. It says, as the time approached for him to be taken up into heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. At that particular place in Luke's gospel, he's only about a third of the way into the life of Jesus, and already Jesus' sights are set on the cross. He hits the campaign trail. Every place where he stops, he preaches and teaches as if it's his last lecture. He has this electric energy that draws followers. And so we learn early on who is welcomed to be part of that campaign caravan. And it can't be someone who wants to bury their dead parent before they come and follow him. It can't be someone who wants to go and kiss their spouse goodbye before jumping on the wagon with Jesus and heading off. It can't be someone who wants a comfortable hotel bed and shower every night in order to be ready for ministry the next day. It has to be people who are ready to commit to an arduous trip and see it through to the very end. Jesus has no time to waste. He's hot. He's red hot. And if you have a Bible that has red lettering for his words in it, I invite you to go back to chapter 9, verse 51 of Luke's gospel, and then just flip the pages and you'll see as we build up to where we started today in Luke 18, that it's mostly red letters. It's mostly Jesus preaching, teaching, healing, exercising demons with a little bit of narration made by Luke along the way. Word is traveling like wildfire. The fan base is exploding. It's interesting to me that there weren't a lot of geographical details that were given to Jesus' trip, to any particular leg of the journey. We don't necessarily know where he is. He keeps on the move, but we don't know where that happens. There aren't too many names that are given for who Jesus is with. Always the disciples are with him. They're the inner core of followers. But beyond that, it doesn't seem like any one name is more important than another. In his urgency to get his message out, he breaks Sabbath rules so that he can express compassion to those who are suffering. He continues to deflect any comments that don't build up his overarching message. There's one instance where a woman is so moved by his outreach that she cries out to him to give praise to his mother. She says, blessed is the mother who gave you birth and nursed you. Jesus easily could have used that moment as sort of a Mother's Day moment where he'd give praises to his Blessed Virgin Mother Mary. But instead, he keeps his followers on task by reminding them of what really matters. He says, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. I think that may have landed with a thud. This compliment to Mary, and yet he says, rather, it's my family are comprised of those who listen for God and obey. And so with that startling reply, Jesus is off. He's heading to the next destination. He's wasting no time. He's urgently drawing people into a life-giving relationship with God. The only hint at geography is found in Luke 13:22, where Luke writes, Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. The only name that is mentioned is Jerusalem. Nothing else seems to matter, including names of people. It was a long journey, and we've walked with him all along in the season of Lent. Jesus poured himself out for the well-being of others, and my guess is that by the time they could see Jerusalem on the horizon, that Jesus was going on mere fumes. So today we stand at the city gates on this Palm Sunday, and we gather with all the witnesses over the course of time who gathered to be a part of that last week of Jesus' life as he goes toward the cross, and we know toward resurrection. I like the picture that's painted in the psalm that Sherry read for us. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. With boughs in hand, join in the festal procession. I wonder if you even remember when we started our Lenten journey. February 26, Ash Wednesday, we met in North Kent Presbyterian Church. Four churches joined together in a joint worship service. I think we had about 25 singers who joined together in a mass choir and did a fantastic job of moving us through their music. We had ashes smeared across our foreheads in the form of a cross to remind us of our mortality and the fleeting nature of our earthly lives. And there is absolutely no way we could have known at that point just how clear the message of our mortality would become over the course of this particular Lenten journey. Like Jesus' final walk to Jerusalem, we have passed through this church season that is always heavy, with an increased sense of urgency and with a sense of foreboding. We started out in a crowd of four congregations that sat next to each other, joyfully loving that we were united in Christ, and now we find ourselves isolated in our own homes with the companionship only of those who are our most trusted earthly companions. Jesus had mobs who surrounded him during his campaign, if you will, but he ends up on the cross alone with only his mother and a few other faithful followers who are seeing him through, keeping a vigil until the bitter end. Does it seem like an eternity ago that we were able to move about freely in crowds, that we hugged each other, that we shared food together, that we sat next to strangers at concerts? Does it seem like ages ago that we set our alarms, that we got up, that we showered, that we put on whatever professional clothing we're asked to wear, and we went to our places of work to do a set of tasks to which we were accustomed? It seems as if we, even though we are just 2 weeks into a mandatory shelter in place, that we have fallen into this kind of warp that we can't really believe where we find ourselves. And geography doesn't really matter, because all that we have is our small space, and what we know is that all of us on the face of the globe, not just our community, but on the face of the globe, are united together in trying to survive a very difficult time. We know that our best hope is to stay at a safe distance from each other, and that is a difficult thing for us. We were a different people as we so blithely streamed forward that evening of Ash Wednesday to have the grit of the ashes and the oil of anointing placed upon our foreheads. And the words that are uttered sound to us even more than usual. From dust you came, and to dust you shall return, but praised be the name of the Lord. How those words echo forth now from hospital chambers and homes. Each day, as we churn toward Jerusalem with Jesus keeping him company, we lose just a little bit more of our innocence. The ashes have long since rubbed off from that evening, but we're reminded of our mortality now in a number of different ways. I think of the 18-wheeler refrigerator trucks that have pulled up next to hospitals in New York City, serving as makeshift morgues, and people are horrified to see that it has come to this. As we resolve to make certain sacrifices to honor the Lenten season, we add something to our normal daily routine, or we take something away to experience the suffering that Jesus offered. But as we made those commitments, we could not imagine, for example, a woman who would forego the opportunity to go be by her husband's bedside as he lay dying because she didn't want to use up the one mask she would need that could potentially save the life of one of his caregivers. Somehow giving up chocolate or cutting back on our time with social media pale in comparison to the sacrifices that our medical community are making, putting themselves at risk, succumbing to the disease, isolating themselves from their families for long periods of time so that they don't carry the coronavirus home with them and infect their own. We didn't know it on Ash Wednesday, but we were babes in the faith who were being prepared for one of the most difficult struggles that we have had as a nation. This passage that Brandon read for us ends with Jesus weeping over the city of Jerusalem because the residents in that sacred holy city didn't recognize Jesus for who he was. They didn't understand that God had sent Jesus as the Messiah, that God had sent him to save them. They were quagmired in their daily routines. They were fixated on trivial concerns so that they missed this love letter that was sent to them to bring them relief from their captivity. We all entered into Lent with a certain set of priorities and an understanding of how the world works. And yet we have discovered that we have had to closely examine the foundations upon which we have built our lives to see if that foundation will support us, our loved ones, our family, our community, our nation, our world. Is what we put in place sufficient to undergird us for this journey? Will those stones of our foundation support us? Like Jesus on his journey toward Jerusalem, we have witnessed untold suffering. I think we brace ourselves for the news many times now because it's so difficult and yet so essential that we see what is going on. We have felt powerless over the forces that threaten our very lives, and we cower before the threat of death that seems only a handshake away. We know that Luke was a social justice advocate, and so he didn't hesitate to make value judgments on those he saw around him. He offers a kind of unusual aside, Luke as the narrator in his own gospel, and that's in chapter 16, verse 14. He says, "The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all this and were sneering at Jesus." These were the privileged of their society. Their sense of entitlement convinced them that they would never have enough, and so they would have been some of the original hoarders with a fierce instinct kicking in to protect what they understood to be what was their own. And without even thinking, as they witnessed this parade that was happening and all the people standing there at the city gates singing the praises and waving their branches to Jesus, they cried out, "Teacher, teacher, rebuke your disciples." It's almost like they were embarrassed by this emotional outcry, but really what underlay that comment, that plea with Jesus, was jealousy. They were jealous of his popularity. Jesus' body moved with the slow gait of a donkey, and he returned their question, their cry, and he said, "I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. The stones will cry out." It was a clash between the way and the establishment. Jesus never mentions Rome. His whole ministry, he never mentions Rome. He lived his life under the oppressive regime of the Roman Empire, and the seat of the government was in Rome. All roads lead to Rome, is the saying. And yet Jesus never once mentioned it. Again, places have little significance except for Jerusalem. His fervent message all along was still the same one that he offered to the woman who tried to give a compliment to Mother Mary at the beginning of his journey. "Blessed, rather, are those who hear the word of God and obey it." That priority is the same for residents of Rome as it is for those in Nazareth. It's the same for Judas Iscariot as it is for John the Baptist. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Social distinctions, human categories are meaningless. What matters is being obedient. And so it's not surprising that Jesus' disciples, a chapter earlier from our reading today, cried out to him, "Increase our faith." Well, this is the first time in our country that we have united together against an enemy that has no face. It can only be seen under a microscope, and so we don't know how to protect ourselves. We've wasted no time in having to stir up hatred and vengeance toward a human enemy. It's a very different kind of battle we've had. And so with our highly planned out schedules put on hold, we're wading into choppy waters, not sure if they will overtake us, as they have already for thousands in our country and tens of thousands around the globe. We take a deep breath and we're mindful of what a blessing that is. Given the nature of the disease, we're mindful of what a blessing it is to be able to take in a deep breath that offers us life, and we gaze upon our loved ones, sometimes from a distance, and recognize how precious they are to us. We dig deep to hear God's word and to respond with a willing yes. Yes, God. Our heroes have changed since we began this Lenten journey. The establishment salutes the highest ranking commanders, those who have earned their way in some sort of public process. But followers in the way of Jesus herald those unsung heroes right now, who we recognize as being the doctors and nurses who are caring for those, for the sick and dying, putting themselves at risk so that they can restore to health those patients and send them home to live out the rest of their lives in a healthy way. We offer our profound thanks to emergency responders who are heading into circumstances that, again, the invisible enemy lurks and many times infiltrates their body and knocks them down. And so we share our love through closed windows, through doorways. Our children draw pictures that we send to seniors who are in sequestered quarters. Our neighbors make palms available to on their mailbox so we can take them and be recognizing that this is Palm Sunday when it may not feel like that at all. And we are called on this day to remember Jesus, who rode into Jerusalem sovereign, ready to take on the ills of the city and knock down the enemy that kept his people captive. If the crowd of common folks like ourselves had not sung his praises, the very rocks and stones would have caused a ruckus. Inanimate objects recognized Jesus for who he was. They recognized his authority when the religious bigwigs could not or would not. The beauty of today, of Palm Sunday in the church calendar, that there is this one moment in Jesus' earthly life where he is heralded as he ought to have been heralded, where the people seem to recognize that he is the promised Messiah, the Son of David, the Savior Messiah. And they sacrifice their only overcoat. We have closets full of clothing. They have one coat. They would lay it out so that there was a sort of red carpet processional for him that he could walk on with the donkey, when an ill-prepared city government was not willing to do that. They rejoiced because the stone that the builders rejected had become the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone upon which the whole setting of our corporate spiritual life would be anchored and would hold us in very uncertain times. It didn't matter that the establishment didn't rejoice in him. For a moment in that crowd, Rome did not control them. And as they waved their palm branches in that exuberant parade, their voices combined with that of the rocks and the stones and the wind and the birds, and they sang the praises of the one that they knew had come to save them. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, which means save us. Hosanna, and glory in the highest. Amen. Let's pray together. God, in this scary time, we too on this Palm Sunday cry out, Hosanna. Save us. Save our loved ones. Save our world. We ask this in the power of Jesus' name. Amen. When we break bread together, we remember that Jesus many times sat at table with men and women and children eating meals with them. It wasn't simply the Last Supper that he did that. And so we wanted to create on this Communion Sunday an opportunity for us as a church body to gather together, even in some non-traditional way, to celebrate the togetherness, the unity that we find through the sacrament of communion. Jesus used the parable of the great banquet in order to help people understand what the family of God looks like. We could call that the kingdom of God. And God knew that we needed connection, that we needed relationships, and that happens in a very personal way around our tables. Jesus many times invited the most unlikely guests to come to his table to join him, always pushing the boundaries of social norms and reminding us that we too ought to be certain that our homes, that our tables, that our churches are open to receive those in perhaps who are not often welcomed at other people's tables. And so he challenges us to do that. And even now, when we are not able to be physically present to one another, we know that Christ binds us together in a unique and wonderful way. It's a difficult time for us to be separated from our loved ones. Undoubtedly, as you sit at your tables where we've asked you to be today with some sort of food that would represent a breakfast for you, you recognize and have memories of those who have been with you at that table before, those you wish could be with you now, but you're separated from them because of social distancing. And so I invite you to take a moment, if you're on your own, to lift up the names in your own heart to God. If you're with another person or a family, together to share those names of the ones that you miss and that you love. And during that time, Doug will be playing Blessed Be the Name of the Lord, and you're welcome to sing along with that if you wish. Physically present to us, and yet we rejoice that his spirit is always near, always guiding, always comforting us. And so that presence of Christ, even though bodily absent, should be a comfort to us as well as we are separated from our loved ones. And so we also want to call to mind the people that we cannot name, the folks that we do not know, but that we know are reliant upon our prayers today. And so, as is our custom, we light a candle to remember that we bring into God's attention those for whom we carry our concerns as a light that shines in dark places. And so I invite you into a time of guided prayer, and from that we will then move into saying the Lord's Prayer together. So let us be in a spirit of prayer. Holy God, we come to you and we are mindful of the separation that we have from loved ones, the people we miss, the hugs that we yearn for. And we know that you are with us in this dark time as not just a nation, but a world. And so we lift up to you prayers for the healing mercies of your Son, Jesus. We pray that as your Spirit moved over the face of the deep at the time of creation, that even now there will be an outpouring of your Spirit so that healing graces can take place. We certainly have seen that in the showings of kindness and generosity and unusual acts of love in this time of pandemic. And so we are thankful for those, and we pray that you would continue to move us to serve you in different and new ways. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, who perhaps all the more in this time of isolation feel their absence. We pray for those who are sick and dying. We pray for those who are caring for loved ones who are sick at home. We pray for the medical caregivers and their families who are many times separated from each other. We pray from those who are separated now, those who are feeling alone and isolated, who are wondering how long this will have to carry on. We are praying for those who are helping and are so very tired. We pray for those who are struggling to find friends and food and community, those for whom this crisis has led to restricted finances and a scary wondering about how they will be able to pay their bills and have food and will become more reliant upon the mercy of others. And so we pray for them in these scary times. We pray for those who are afraid. We pray for those who are in our church body who are in need of prayers. We pray that they can feel our love for them and that we will find ways to reach out that assure them of our nearness, if not in body, then in spirit. On this Palm Sunday, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who rode triumphantly into Jerusalem and took on the establishment to let them know that it was his way that would carry forth over the course of time and not the massive Roman Empire or any government, no matter how powerful since then. So we raise our voices along with that crowd, singing, Hosanna, save us. Hear us now as we offer the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us to pray, saying one with the other, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I would invite you to take a deep breath on behalf of those whose needs we do not know, and to do so knowing that God honors the prayers of all of us that we offer on behalf of complete strangers. Take a deep breath, knowing that that is a gift of God through the Spirit that blows us outward into acts of compassion. Blessings at the table are a usual part of our Judeo-Christian tradition. Many of us start our meals with a word of grace. Jesus took a traditional time of prayer in his people's history and transformed it by having bread and juice. Bread and drink, and saying, this is a way I want you to remember me, and eating these common elements, drinking of this cup. And so we continue to do that. And that's why we call our communion prayer the Great Thanksgiving, because it leads us to a place of being thankful that we have this Savior. So again, at your table, whether alone or with a family, I invite you to lift up into God's hearing the things for which you are grateful, even in the midst of this very trying time. And you may join in singing as Doug plays for us, Oh, How He Loves You and Me. Thank you. so we gather around our tables for a feast of love, and it is easy to find love in the midst of these hard times. So I would ask a prayer on these common elements, mine and yours, at our tables that are part of a breakfast that we would perhaps enjoy on any given morning. Will you join me in prayer? God, over these elements of the earth, over bread and cup, we ask for your blessing, and we ask that in this time that we are physically apart, that you will nonetheless transform what we place before you with gratitude and make it a means of your grace. Sanctify this feast that we may know your love more fully. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. And so it is that we remember on the night of betrayal and desertion by his closest friends that Jesus took the bread. He gave thanks to you for it, O God. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And in like manner, after they had supped, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for many, that sin might be forgiven. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so ministering to you in the name of the crucified and risen Christ, on a week that is so significant in his life, I offer you bread and juice from your tables that are infused with the Holy Spirit. And so I invite you to raise in your own home something from your table that I might offer a blessing on that. So hold it up and let's be in a moment of prayer. Holy Comforter, we gather in your name, invited by Jesus, bound together by your Spirit, and unified one with the other. Feed our bodies and our spirits with your comforting presence, so that we might be your comfort to others. Bless this food, and may it break open our hearts. Bless this drink, and help us to pour your love out on a hurting world. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we have feasts of love at our table, whatever that may look like in your home. And we share in that together, remembering that communion is a great mystery, that Christ is present, that Christ loves us. And so I would invite you, as you prepare to have your meal around the table, to now join, before your mouth is too full, in joining a final hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. Amen. Sisters in Christ, on this Palm Sunday, I thank you for joining us. And now may you shelter not only in place, but in peace. And may the love and comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you as we walk through this holy week together. Amen.